Well, we know this is inaugural week. The President of the United States will be inaugurated again. And there's a lot of hype connected to it. And something that is very disturbing in regard to that, and that is the growing cult of the leader, which I'll get into in a moment. But first, let me express my opinion that I think that inaugurations are becoming a little bit too much. In an age when we're spending far too much money, rolling up deficits and things like that, particularly a second inaugural, why not just get up, go down to the Oval Office, have a common feed from one camera that goes out to the world that all the various channels can feed off of. Simply get sworn in and get to work instead of all of this pomp and ceremony that costs millions of dollars at a time when we should be thinking of frugality. Nobody goes out and holds a banquet when their checking account is empty, and neither should the government. Enough said, but the cult of personality is getting a little bit too much. For instance, yesterday's New York Times, of course you had Obama on the cover, that's fine. Then in the arts and leisure section, movies in the age of Obama, how Hollywood is putting Obama more and more into the movies somehow. But that's Hollywood. As we know, Hollywood is very left. The result of the so-called ban of communists out of Hollywood, in reality, produced more leftists in Hollywood than getting rid of them. Then the Sunday Review, Obama is a baseball player, managing the Oval Office. But the other disturbing things are the various photographs you're starting to see of Obama wading into a crowd and allowing that crowd to put their arms around them and hug him and embrace him and touch him and that sort of thing. The Secret Service would never, ever allow that sort of thing if it was spontaneous. It has to be staged. It has to be allowed for these photographs to show the love of the people for the president. But it gets worse. It gets worse, and I've shown this to you before, I believe, where Obama was depicted in a painting in a pose as if he was hanging on a cross like Jesus Christ with thorns around his head. And then on this last week, on the 18th of January, in Newsweek, which has gone online now, by the way, it's no longer put out on the newsstand, you have a picture of Obama in his normal El Duce pose. For those of you who do not know who El Duce was, he was the head of fascist Italy, Mussolini. He posed with his chin in the air all the time. But it's the title, The Second Coming. And it's just incredible that they would use these blasphemous titles and that sort of thing, as if there's something more to this man than simply being a representative of the people to run the administration. It is a cult of leadership that they have begun with this individual, quite reminiscent of what they used to do in ancient Rome, to where the leader ultimately became known as a god, or in Greece as well. Alexander wanted to be known as a god. And so there's this idea of the complete adulation of the people for the president, and the fact that this, you know, the references to him and Christ are unbelievable. At any rate, I think that this is something that we've got to really watch in ourselves, even within heroes in the conservative and constitutional movement. We're all just individualists. We're all just doing a job. Some of us have different positions and different things that we do within the movement. But we shouldn't fall for this hero worship, particularly to the point where we get with the current president. The two previous presidents where they came close to this was FDR, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, and certainly John F. Kennedy, more after he was martyred than before. But at any rate, We've seen an awful lot about guns this past week. In the newspapers, it says even defining assault weapons is difficult, or assault rifles is complicated. Even defining assault rifles is complicated. Well, it's not very complicated if you understand what is really going on. An assault weapon is defined in reality, in practice, not necessarily in verbiage, but in practice, an assault weapon is anything that can match or come close to anything a government has in its arsenal. That's simple when it comes to a hand-to-hand combat type of weapon. So you can think about that one for a moment. It's not how long it is, how many bullets it has in the magazine, or anything else. It's anything that might possibly match what a government has in its arsenal that's issued to its armed forces. Think about that one in relationship to why the Second Amendment was established to begin with. Now, I recommend, it's not entirely good, but it's very good in many, many ways, an article that you might want to look up online in the Wall Street Journal, and it was last Friday, January 18th in 2013, The Facts About Assault Weapons and Crime by John R. Lott, Jr. The Facts About Assault Weapons and Crime in the Wall Street Journal last Friday, again, January 18th. I think you'll find it very interesting. And in regards to all of this business in the way of guns, let me quote a line from Patrick Henry, one of the great patriots in the War of Independence, and helped bring about the Revolution and so forth. He said this, and keep this in mind in regard to the Second Amendment. The Constitution is not an instrument for the government to restrain the people. It is an instrument for the people to restrain the government, lest it come to dominate our lives and our interests. And that's exactly what they're doing with outlawing guns, or trying to outlaw guns. We tried to outlaw drugs. Has it worked? We tried to outlaw alcohol during Prohibition. Did it work? We're trying to outlaw terror. Is it working? And in each one of those cases, the problem became worse because government got involved in trying to stop these things. As an example, the Arab Spring, the much-vouted, touted Arab Spring in Egypt now, you've got a serious problem. Now, the fellow who runs Egypt, Morsi, is now denying these things, but the other day it came out that as a leader in the Muslim Brotherhood, he said things like this during a speech urging Egyptians to, quote, nurse our children and our grandchildren on hatred, unquote, for Jews and Zionists. In a television interview around that time, the same leader described Zionists as, quote, these bloodsuckers who attack the Palestinians, these warmongers, the descendants of apes and pigs, unquote. That's the president of Egypt that three organizations went over and created the Arab Spring. Three organizations with members of the Council on Relations in their leadership from the United States. And this is what it's producing. It will produce another war. They're concerned about Iran and Iraq now, because Iraq is becoming more and more an ally of Iran. But maybe they better look more to the south, to their traditional enemy, Egypt, because if this is true, what this man says, it does not bode well for the future. Now, he's saying that these are taken out of context. Well, I see that they're in quotes. I do know there are times when the newspapers misquote people and that sort of thing. But if this man is anything like what they quote him as being, there's serious problems going to be, we're going to have serious problems in the Middle East. Not just from the north in Syria and in Iraq and Iran relative to the Israeli state, but also from Egypt. Until next week, we'll see you then.